Has that ever happened to you? When it happens, what do you normally do? You make excuses or prayers or plea for the cause, right? And this lady was Christian. So when cop pulled her over, she lifted up quick prayer. And then she claimed that Lord God has given her a sentence to say. And so she said to the police, "Blessed are those who are merciful. They will receive mercy." And the policeman gave her a ticket and says, "What? Go sin no more." And she just protested that she was driving along with the traffic, flow of traffic. Everybody else was driving 65 down the hill. And why me? Right? Have you seen anybody driving down this Haleakala Mountain Highway right on the speed limit? Not even police, not even Paul Kellyans do that. When you get caught, guess what? You have a Paul Kelly Church bumper sticker on your... And yet, I do too. And my son said that if he doesn't speed up, go with the flow, then people are going to get mad at him or give him something. So, give him finger, and so therefore, he's driving over the limit. I mean, you know, I do too. Confess. This is hard for us to go against current practice. Sort of speak, the norm of society. And we are in the world, and the world, everybody else is influencing us instead of us influencing them. You know, as Christians, we should be really good law-abiding citizens, don't you think? Huh? Only Dorothy says yes. Welcome to the church-wide Bible study series from the book of Daniel. And this book will teach us how to stand up for God's standard and how to stand against cultural norm, how to live life worthy of being God's children, how to show what it means to be Christians and to be God's children. You know the background of this book, right? And Daniel was a young teenager. It depends on which commentary you are reading. 13, 14, 15, 16, whatsoever, it's a teenage years that Israelites got invaded by Babylonians. This is the first exile we are talking about, right? And then the king Nebuchadnezzar, they asked really good hunky-dory man of Hebrews, right? No blemish and good and educatable, teachable kids to come to be educated to serve him, the king Nebuchadnezzar. So they were taken into this indoctrination, brainwashing the education system for 3 years. Now, even then, they didn't compromise. They refused to be assimilated into Babylonian culture. And we can see, when, as we study from beginning till end, we can see how they stood up for God and how they were raised, praised God's name through their lives. They, through their lives and through their activities and words and actions, they praise God. How great is our God? So that is what this study is all about. If when you think that this book, Daniel, is about lions then, or the furnace, think again. It is about how great our God is. It's all incident after incident. This book points to God's grace, God's omnipotence, omnipresence, omniscience. It's all about praising God. Now, one thing that I want to make sure that get out of my mind and I'm stirring nervous about whenever Rhonda looks at me. You know, when I say Daniel, and some people corrected me saying, is that I didn't pronounce it very well, did I? So sounded like a Daniel, right? So I'm not saying Daniel. You all know. So, yeah? So that get out of the way. So don't look at me. She's my pronunciation teacher. So, where was I? Daniel. So, in the lesson one this week, you all gonna engage in a Bible study, lesson one. And if you're not in a Bible study group, please join. And, you know, if you don't like any of the Bible study groups listed on the in the back of the bulletin, create one, right? And you don't have time, what? Make time to study the Word of God. Amen? And then lesson one is about the title. Do any of you know the title of the lesson one? It is, Have You Got What It Takes? Have you got what it takes to stand up for God, to live a life of counter to culture? It's a kind of sanctification. We call it counterculture sanctification. Now, you all know salvation has two parts, right? And one is what? Justification. When you believe in Jesus Christ, accepted as your Lord and Savior, you are adopted into God's family. You are saved. But there is another part, the sanctification, how we all live while we are on this earth. And sanctified, getting into what? In the journey of sainthood, right? Sanctification. And this book will teach us how to live to counter to culture sanctification so that we can enjoy what the Christ has come to give us before we go there, before we enter into heaven. And we are ready to hear what? Well done, my good and faithful servants. Amen? So I've come up with we can do at least 2 hours, then we can say, I've got what it takes to live life of counterculture sanctification. Amen? So how do we do? Let us ponder upon 2 hours, what it takes. Do you have you got what it takes? Do you have what it takes to praise God's name on high, to stand against culture, stand up for your God. Now, verse 8. Look at verse 8. Verse 8 says what? They, before even this, they changed the Hebrew guy's name to Babylonian's name, and that was okay to them, I guess, when they brought first meal to them, and Daniel and his Hebrew friends, four of them, says what? No, thank you, right? So, do you think these guys made a big deal out of nothing? We're not talking about hamburgers and French fries. I would say no, thank you. I never really enjoyed hamburgers. Nothing against McDonald's, but it was the greatest meal in a king's court. I mean, fine wine and a gourmet food. What on earth? They refused to eat. Give us just veggies and water. What is that? Do you know why? Because it was, first of all, offered to gods of Babylonians. And it was tainted already. And also they were keeping the laws of Moses. Thou shalt not eat this and eat that, right? And did you know that when God created us, we're supposed to be vegetarians? How many of you are vegetarian? Vegan? Nobody! After the fall, nobody was vegetarian anymore. But the supposedly modern day's diet, and you know, they advertise the vegetarians live longer and healthier. Is that true? No. He's a meat eater. So, Daniel was, and then his friends, four Jewish boys, refusing to accept, eat, dine with all other people were in that cadet. And this is a great thing that we can learn. He says, he asked permission to the giver. He says, do not defile yourself in this way. Because this person who's giving them the food has to make them look healthy for the presentation to the king. For 3 years, they've got to do this. And if they are not healthy, then this guy gonna get in trouble. So Daniel's attitude, and it says, resolve what? Not to defile himself. And also he got the permission for him not to defile himself too. You know, a lot of times, it's not easy to say no to the culture. No to the party, no to the little speed going, driving over the speed limit. It's hard. Even then, we know the standards, what God teaches us, right? When we say no, we got to learn from this book that we got to be polite. Do not offend anybody. Use Bible. The truth that I know, like hammer and judgmental, right? And criticizing those things, thou shalt not, right? This book teaches us that. And there was a story about a manager who had a hard task to accomplish. And there was a man in his company who was so sweet and friendly and everybody loved him, but he was stuck at his job. So company decided to fire him, and this manager is supposed to say that to his face, right? Nobody wanted to do. So the manager said, you know, I can never ever imagine what we can do without you. And the young man says, oh, thank you very, very much. But there is a part coming, right? But the manager says what? We have to try to get going without you from next Monday. Not funny. I missed the punchline. I'm all over. Be polite when you say and when you refuse to compromise. And that is the very hardest task we can ever do, right? And thou shalt not compromise. And this tells us, you know, the other day I was watching Denzel Washington. I never knew he was a Christian. And he had this commencement speech, and that got caught in my ear. He says, whatever he said in the beginning, I don't know. He said, no matter what you do, put God first in your life. I said, wow, wow. This is what these four Jewish people, the boys, were doing. They put God first in their lives and refused to compromise with the Babylonian culture, Babylonian teachings. I mean, brainwash, indoctrination. They were refusing that. You know what the Word of God says? We live in a world, it's easy for us to be contaminated, conformed to the patterns of this world. And Romans 12, 2, right? Do not, what? Conform to the patterns of the world, but what? Be transformed by the Word of God. How is it going to happen? When you stand strong inside, when you, all your allegiance and devotions go to serve the man who died upon that tree. Only a God like him that we are going to serve. I mean, there is somebody made an observation, the rocks in the rivers. And the rocks been there all these years. But once they took them out and cracked open, guess what? Inside is what? Bone dry. Do you say that? Inside wasn't contaminated at all. But rocks didn't have a choice, right? The waters gushing through, they were in the water all these years, but they weren't contaminated. They were inside, was born dry. And that is what the Christians, we cannot help living in this sin-sick world, but we can protect our inside. We can transform ourselves with the Word of God, our mind, renew our minds, so that we have energy, we have bones to stand up against what is not right. And praising God, refuse to compromise with the politeness. That's, if we can do that, that's when we can say, hey, I've got what it takes to praise our God, his name on high. Amen? So what would be our first R? Refuse what? To compromise. You are smart cookies. And the second R is this. Verse 18 and 19. And it says what? At the end of a period that king has set time for them, and then they were presented to the king, right? And then what happened? King talked to them, right? And the king was what? So surprised, astonished by their knowledge and wisdom and etc. And the king says, none have ever, never seen, none like those people. What happened? Were they originally very smart? Maybe. But look at, go up verse 17. What does it say? Verse 17. Who gave them the power and knowledge and understanding and have all the dreams and visions? Who? Oh, my God. What is that? Who gave them? Amen. God gave them. Why did God bestow upon them such a blessing and such anointing? Why have God done that? Because they put God first, right? And they put God first and they all their allegiance and devotions to serve their God. And so that therefore God's blessings and favor rest upon them. And also, they were relying on what? God's power upon them. You know, sanctification, counter to culture sanctification, without God's power, without God's Holy Spirit, without understanding that we cannot. I don't know about you, I can't. I am so rotten inside. I've got to let God working in my life, working in my heart. And I've got to rely on God's power to lift me up. Otherwise, I'll be... You know, Isaiah said, Isaiah 40, 31, I'm not sure, said, but you know all this, you know about this phrase. Those who wait upon the Lord will soar like an eagle. Renew their strength, right? We say soar like an eagle. When you understand, when we understand what, you know, the eagles, habitation of eagles, and how they prepare for the storms, then you will understand that passage very, very clearly well. Eagles, they say, they instinctively know the storm's coming. So they wait for the storm. They're not going to avoid the storm. They wait for the storm and then wait for the wind to come. And then what? They use that wind to push them higher up above the storm of their lives. They can enjoy, rise higher. That is what God has in mind for all of us. That we, when we rely on God's power, the instinct and the Holy Spirit in us teaches us, guides us, right? Convicts us. If when we rely on that power, we can always rise above. Always, any situation, any circumstances, any cultural norms or anybody, you know, we all wanted to fit in, right? We wanted to be accepted. We don't want to be look weird. But when the Spirit of God in you, and when we decided, resolve not to defile ourselves and stand for our God, and we can rely on God's power. I mean, Psalm 37, 23 says this. Good man's step, God will guide, something like that. And the good man is, the language is strong. Those who stand strong for their God. Who's gonna guide their steps? God will guide their steps. That's exactly what these four Hebrew boys have done. God has guided their steps. Are you stand strong for your God? If you are, God's going to. Yeah, bless your socks off. Amen. God's going to make things, you know, make things prepared for you. God's going to work everything, what? All things around good for you. God's going to, because this is what happened to these boys. God gave them wisdom. God gave them understanding. God gave them wisdom and visions and can solve all the dreams. You know, I know we talked about we are good people, but we are good people, right? Things can be evil, right? Sometimes. And we only have to rely on God's power. And John, 1 John chapter 4, verse 4, this is my favorite verse, right? You all know that, right? And what? You have overcome all the things. Because what? The one who is in you is greater than the one who is in the world. Who is in the world, the persecutions, temptations, and headaches and heartaches and all those problems in the world, you have overcome. You have a power to overcome because the one is in you is greater than the one who is in the world. Hallelujah. Our God is greater. Shout it. Our God is greater than any other. When our God is for us, whom then? Whom then shall I fear? Who can be against us? Romans 8:31. I mean, that's got to be our core foundation to live a counterculture sanctification, to work into, mature into what? Sainthood. When we are able to do that, then we can say, yes, I've got what it takes. Amen? So what is the second arm? Rely on what? God's power. Amen? Do you ever get tempted with the food? Huh? Yes? Those of you who know me, who's been eating out with me, you all can make one sentence, right? Wow, she can eat, right? And then those guests, they will say to all of you, wow, Paul Kellyanne can eat. Amen. Amen. Food tempts us all the time, right? And there was a comedian, I believe, and he was known to have Atkins diet or whatsoever. He just supposedly eat meat and to lose some weight. So on an interview, they asked, the interviewer, the host asked, how's your diet going? And he goes, not too well. You know, I am a strong man, but the linguine is stronger. Temptations and temptations. What can we do, right? And the world around us tempts us with all sorts of things. And we wink at it. We go along with what everybody else was doing. And we stand for nothing. You know, somebody says, if you stand for nothing, you will, what? Fall for everything, anything. Those four Hebrew boys stand for God's glory. They proclaimed how great their God is and was is to come. And they lived a life of counterculture, sanctification. Can we do that? Can we do that? Do you?
Yes.
Yes. All right. How can we? Have you got what it takes? First of all, at least to us, right? What is it? Refuse to compromise and then rely on God's power. Good job. And God's going to bless your socks off. Amen.